How are you? How about your homework, which I had given you for the last class? You did not attend it, okay. How about Dipali? Dipali, I think, is not there right now. So, any questions so far, Nikhila? Any doubts? Have you been studying working capital management for the test? No doubts. Okay. So today I'm going to start with you security analysis and portfolio management. A new topic, very, very interesting, but a subject in itself. So therefore, you have to now, look at the subject from a new perspective. Whatever we were discussing so far was relating to financial management. Now we are going to start with another area of taxation, which is security analysis and portfolio management. I think Dipali has sent me the answer on WhatsApp right now. I think this is an incomplete answer, Dipali. And this is one question which I had done in the class also. I have given you the solution of this question in the class itself, and the solution which has come to me from your side, it includes factoring commission and interest charges, then firm saving on factoring service, okay, so you have done it in a very short way, which I had discussed in the class. And I'd given the full solution in the class itself. Now, starting with security analysis and portfolio management, as I was saying, it's a new topic. So for this new topic, if you really want a good and an advanced author, you must read the book written by Fisher and Jordan. It is named as Security Analysis and Portfolio Management by Fisher and Jordan, a wonderful author and a very wonderfully written book on the topic itself. If you come across this book or if you can take a copy of it, I think, it will be very, very good. You can just read through the introductory chapters and you would be really very happy to study this particular topic. Now, what are we exactly talking about security analysis and portfolio management, and why would we like to go for security analysis and portfolio management? This is a topic which is more concerned with your investments, right? Because when you want to invest certain money, then you will decide, and if you decide to invest this money in securities, then you would decide to go for security analysis and portfolio management, right? So therefore, when we start this topic, we'll first understand the concept of investments in itself, and then we will move on security analysis. So what is an investment? Investment is like if I've got some surplus money, and if I want to, give it to somebody or to invest it somewhere, for a particular period of time when I'm expecting certain return, right? And I'm ready to take some amount of risk. So when I'm ready to take some risk and I invest my money for a particular period of time with an objective to get some return on it, that is called an investment. I would be getting the money after a particular period of time. Now the question is that how do we get our required rate of return? How do I select those investments which give me my required rate of return? For the risk that I'm ready to take, am I being adequately compensated in terms of return? That is what we'll be doing in security analysis and portfolio management. But as I said, that we have to first understand investments and then we understand the role of security analysis and portfolio management in the investment activity. So when I'm talking about investment, I'm talking about two kinds of investments, real investment and financial investment. Now when we talk about real investment, that means if I've got money, I can buy assets out of that money, isn't it? I can buy a house, I can invest it in a factory, I can invest it in some gold. So these are called real investments, when you get real assets out of that particular investment. The second way of making an investment is not to make investment in the real assets, but rather than that, you can make investments in the financial assets. That means you can buy bonds, you can buy securities, you can buy equity shares, you can buy treasury bills, you can buy, you know, debentures of the companies. And thereby, you're giving your money to the company and the company is collecting money to make some real investment. Right? So you can make a real investment or you can make a financial investment. Difference between real investment and financial investment is clear? Is the difference between the two clear? So now if I try to distinguish between the two, the real investment and financial investments have got two different objectives altogether. When I make a real investment, I'm not looking for that kind of a liquidity which I'm looking in a financial investment. Because in a financial investment, I can sell that investment at any point of time and get my money back. But when it comes to real investment, it becomes at times very difficult to liquidate a real investment. Like if you decide to invest it in a property, it takes some time because there is no liquid market for buying and selling the properties. So we need to have in the real investment, liquidity is lower. Second thing is that, in the real investment, the amount which is invested is comparatively higher than the amount that you can invest in a financial investment. Financial investment can be done merely with 5,000 rupees, but you hardly get anything in real investment with 5,000 rupees, right? So as the liquidity is lower, so the time expectation, the horizon of investment in a real investment is longer as compared to a financial investment. You can make a financial investment even for a period of a week, but you or even you can do an intraday investment in financial world. But in real investment, you need to invest it for a minimum period of 3 to 5 years. Right. So therefore, you know, when we talk about real and financial investments, they're two different activities altogether. And financial investments basically require a lower amount of money. It requires a lower time horizon and at the same time, it is very, very liquid. But there is a basic... Now when I'm talking about financial investment, there are many times that people confuse it with speculation or gambling. Yeah, capital budgeting chapter was concerned with real investment. Very true. Very true. Now from that real investment, now I'm moving to financial investment. Okay. So when we talk about financial investment, I am not talking about speculation in any way. The difference between speculation and investment is that in speculation, we do not do any kind of a groundwork. We do not do any kind of an analysis before taking a decision, right? We just go by rumors or we just go by our gut feeling and we speculate. But when I'm talking about investment requires a complete analysis. And that is why the name of the topic is security analysis, right? So investment requires a complete analysis and speculation does not require any analysis. Similarly, it is not gambling because gambling is a game of chance. Again, gambling also does not require any analysis. But gambling is a game of chance that out of, you know, two dices which have been thrown, you may get above 7 or you may get below 7. That's gambling. But here, in investment, we are not looking for a matter of chance. We are taking a very, very calculated decision to get returns in future. Right? So it is not gambling. It is not speculation. It is investment, which is going to be supported with a lot of analysis, with a lot of expectations, with a lot of calculations and pre-decided time and you know, risk and return criteria. So when we're looking at investments, we would be the constraints, but still there are various constraints in investments as well. The constraints means that, you know, this investment can give you a very high return, but at the same time, the constraints are that you have to invest your money for a particular period of time, right? So for a day, 2 days, 7 days, month, year, 2 years, 5 years, 7 years, 10 years, 20 years, you are going to block your money. Then that is why you're going to get the returns, right? So when we give away our liquidity, we get the returns. So investment will have a particular period of maturity, though you can liquidate it before maturity, but then in order to get the desired returns, there are certain investments which have to be held for a particular period of time. Then, you know, everybody has got a different requirement. So many a times there are people who require regular income. Investments in general, in investments, we expect capital gains. But still in investments, you can also get a regular return in terms of interest, in terms of dividends also. So these are, you know, thereby we will have different kinds of investments that we would be talking about. We would be having different kinds of investors with different kinds of risk tolerance levels. There are some people who make investments only from taxation perspective. Many a times you would see people buying national saving certificates or Kisan Vikas Patra. This is an investment, but the investment is from the perspective of tax liability that they're doing. So from the perspective of investment, rather I would like to divide the investors into three categories. The investors can be considered as aggressive investors, conservative investors, and balance investors. We've got three kinds of investors. An aggressive person, an aggressive investor is a person who takes high risk and expects higher return. This is the investor who generally expects returns in form of capital gains. Right? He does not require a regular income. He's looking for a very high return and he's ready to take a high risk. Then we have a conservative investor. A conservative investor will take a low risk and is happy with a low return. In most of the situations, he is looking for regular income in terms of interest and in terms of dividends, right? And then we have a balance investor. He's looking for safety, yes. Then we have a balance investor who is ready to take some risk, you know. He takes some risk and expects a balanced return, not very high and risk-free kind of a return. He is looking for some risk and he is expecting some return. He is okay with, to wait for some time if he is going to get a good amount of capital gains. But at the same time, if you pay him a regular income, he is happy with that as well. So we've got investors of three different categories in the markets, and all these investors, they participate in the market, and that is why the market, you know, decides the pricing. The price in the markets, the price of a security in the market. Now, when I'm talking about market, I'll be giving you an overview about the market as well. I'm talking about financial markets over here. The price of a security in financial markets is going to be decided by the forces of demand and supply. Though we would be talking about various other approaches to calculation of prices as well, but in most of the situations, we'll come down to a situation of demand and supply only. Okay? Now, when I'm talking about financial markets, I am including in it various markets. In financial markets is a very broad term. It includes various kinds of markets like capital markets, money markets, anybody else who wants to add to it, government securities market, yeah, what are the other forms of markets, bond market, foreign exchange market, derivatives markets, commodities markets, very good. Derivatives market, commodities market, right? So there are various markets which are included in the term financial market. Now when we talk about mutual fund is a part of capital markets only. So what is the differences between these all markets and you know, how are these markets working? See, these markets are nothing but they are like sabzi mandis. You go to a sabzi mandi, right? So in a sabzi mandi, you buy and sell vegetables. There are people who sell, there are people who buy. So it's a market for buyers and sellers of vegetables. Similarly, capital market is a market for buyers and sellers of long-term securities. When I'm talking about long-term, I am talking about equity and bonds, right? So the orientation, the time horizon that an investor has in his mind is around a period of more than 3 years in the capital market. When we talk about money markets, money market is a market for short-term securities. Here we can have securities, we can have transactions with an objective to invest for a period of 1 day to a period of 1 year. Okay? Then we have got a specialized government securities market. It's a market for government securities only. Government issues securities, the state government as well as the central government, both the governments, they issue securities. These securities are generally for a longer period of time. So you can consider it to be a part of capital markets also. Okay, so government securities market is a market which exclusively deals in government securities. These securities can be issued by the central government or by the state government. They're also called dated government securities. Why they're called dated securities? Because the date of maturity is written on the securities itself, and they're also called gilt-edged securities because they are secured by government guarantee, and that is why they're called gilt-edged securities. Is the point getting clear? National savings certificates are not considered as securities. Now, why they're not considered as securities here? Because when we talk about securities, we're talking about those securities which are negotiable in nature. Negotiable means you can buy and sell them. But national savings certificates cannot be bought and sold. If you have national savings certificates in your name, you cannot transfer it to my name. Right? You can simply pledge it to me. You're getting the difference between the two, Ganesh? So, a national savings certificate is not a security. Similarly, the Kisan Vikas Patra, very true. So, these are not considered as securities in the securities market because you cannot buy and sell them. We're talking about those securities which are negotiable in nature. Okay? Similarly, we've got the bond market. Yeah, those which are not transferable are not considered as securities over here. Now we come to the bond market. In the bond market, we buy and sell corporate bonds, right? This market is not very developed in the Indian conditions, but some of the countries like Japan, they have got a very good bond market. But in India, this market is yet to be developed to the stage that we're expecting. Then we have a foreign exchange market in which foreign exchange is bought and sold. Again, it is not a part of financial market because it is a part of financial market, but it is not a securities market because foreign exchange is not a security. But then, you know, foreign exchange can be bought and sold, and that is why it is called a part of financial markets. It is a market in which foreign exchange is bought and sold. Then we've got a derivatives market in which derivative securities are bought and sold. And then we last was the commodities market in which the commodities are bought and sold. Okay? So these are various kinds of markets that we have in the financial markets. But in the objective of the investor when they invest in all these markets is to earn profits, is to get the returns. Okay? By taking some amount of risk, they want to get the return. So now, what we have to do, the fundamental principle is to you take a risk and you get the return, right? You take the risk and you get the return. But then, you know, in some way, as an investor or as an expert in the financial markets, what I want to do is I want to minimize the risk and maximize the return. Right? I want to minimize the risk and I want to maximize the return. The mantra for minimizing the risk and maximizing the return is diversification. I generally give a very, very, a very simple and very, a very lay example in this, which I many a times some of my female friends are very easily able to understand. See, in our home, we keep supports, support staff in terms of maids. There are people who keep two maids. Now, why do they keep two maids? And they pay them also the same amount, right? So, if I have to keep one maid and I have to pay her 5,000 rupees, rather than keeping one maid for 5,000 rupees, I will keep two maids. To one, I will pay 2,000 rupees. And to the other, I will pay 3,000 rupees. Why would I do that? Does it help me in any way? Division of work is okay. If I pay, then they will come to me. Yeah, this is the idea, Ganesh. Actually, if one is absent, at least some part of my work is done. Or maybe the other will be able to give me some support in the remaining work as well. So if one fails, at least the other will perform. You're getting my point? This is the concept of diversification. So far as financial markets are concerned, what we do not invest in one security the entire amount. We invest our amount in different securities. We try to invest our amount in different securities so that if at a particular point of time one of the securities not performing, the other will perform. And then, so that ways you would be able to reduce your risk. Now, and in some of the situations, in some of the families, I find people to be all the more smarter. What they do, they will appoint one Hindu maid and another Muslim maid. Why? How will this help? Yeah. So that means that when the Hindu maid will take a festival chutti, the Muslim maid will work. And when the Muslim maid will take a festival chutti, the Hindu maid will work. So similarly, in the concept of financial markets, we try to invest in those securities which are negatively correlated with each other. Right? So the investment should not be in two securities which move along with each other. Rather, we should try to invest in those securities which are negatively correlated with each other. So when one is performing, the other may not perform. And when the other is performing, the first one may not perform. So you're getting my point. This is called the concept of diversification and creating a portfolio. By creating a portfolio, right, we are able to reduce our risk by using the concept of diversification. Is the point getting clear? Yeah, so the chocolate example will also make the point clear that he is keeping his chocolates at different places so that if the mother or anybody else picks up one, he will have something for himself in the other pocket or in the other place, right? So that is the concept of diversification. We do not invest our complete money in one asset. We try to diversify our investments in different securities, and thereby we combine them in a portfolio. And while deciding that which should be the securities in a portfolio, we try to choose those securities which are negatively correlated with each other. Is the point clear? And that is how we would be able to reduce our level of risk. We would be able to reduce the total risk level. The level of risk is lower than the simple average of all the risks, because they're negatively correlated. We'll be understanding those concepts. We'll be trying to prove those concepts in this particular chapter. So now, what are securities? Because it is the medium of investment. I said that in the why are we using securities? Because we want to invest. So how do securities help in investment? Because they become the medium of investment, right? So what is a security? The legal definition of a security is it's a legal representation of the right to receive prospective future benefit under stated conditions. So in on a security, the security is generated subject to certain conditions, and anybody who would be investing in a security, he will have a right to receive some prospective benefits in future. So this term security is, if we use it very generically, it is used for those securities which are negotiable in nature, which can be bought and sold in the market, right? In generic terms, I'm not talking about a legal definition over here. In general language, we use the term security for those kinds of documents which can be bought and sold in the financial market. So you can have gilt-edged securities, which I was discussing with you, which can be in form of treasury bills, which can be in form of dated government securities, or it can be semi-government dated securities which are issued by the state governments, etc. Right? Or you can have certain securities in form of corporate debentures, which can be mortgage debentures, or that means secured or unsecured debentures. Now in India, we cannot issue unsecured debentures. It can be registered or bearer debentures. Again in India, you cannot issue bearer debentures. You have to issue registered debentures only. Or it can be convertible and non-convertible debentures. And I think in India, again, we have to issue... There are certain industries in which you have to issue only convertible debentures, but non-convertible debentures can also be issued. Then we can have zero coupon bonds also in this. What are zero coupon bonds? These are the bonds on which no interest is paid. Coupon means interest. Okay? So zero coupon bonds are those bonds on which interest is not paid. So you would say that why will I buy a particular bond on which there is no interest payment? So these are the bonds which are issued at a discount to the face value. That means that when these bonds are issued, supposing a 100 rupee bond is issued to you for rupees 95, and then no interest is paid to you, at the time of redemption 100 rupees will be paid to you. Today you pay 95 rupees, after 4 months we'll pay you 100 rupees. That's a zero coupon bond. So there is no coupon rate of interest on it. Whatever is there is whatever benefit you're going to get is going to be in terms of that the bond will be available to you at a discount from the face value. You're able to understand what is a zero coupon bond? Is it clear? Okay. So all money market securities, whether they are treasury bills, because treasury bills are also issued for a period of 91 days. Treasury bills also do not have any rate of interest. They are also issued at a discount to maturity. Okay? Only long-term securities like dated government securities, corporate debentures, they are issued with a coupon rate of interest. All short-term securities are issued at a discount to the face value. Okay? So all money market securities are issued at a discount to the face value. And all capital market securities, if they are in the nature of debentures, etc., they will have a coupon rate of interest. Clear? Then we also have the preference shares as an investment medium. You understand it well, being students of company secretary course. Then we have the equity shares as an investment media, as a security. And you can have mutual fund securities as well. So there are various securities which are available in the market. We will have to choose from considering our investment objectives that which particular security should be invested in and which particular group of securities should be invested in. As I already discussed, there are certain investments which are non-security form of investments like national savings schemes, post office saving deposit schemes, FDs with commercial banks and corporate fixed deposits. They are not negotiable in nature, so they are considered as non-security form of investments in the generic sense. This all is not contained in your study material. It is just for your general knowledge that I am giving you this information, because when you read the study material, at times you would be struck up with these terminologies. So I am just trying to make the terminologies clear. I would be discussing the concepts a little later once I develop the solid foundation. So in the in this particular, if you want to make an investment and you want to invest in securities, you will be investing it in the securities market, right? So as I discussed with you, you can have the capital markets and you can have the money markets. Both of them are securities market. A market is a place where the buyer and the seller are meeting, right? So this markets can be divided into primary markets and secondary markets. Primary markets are those markets in which the companies come up with the public issue, and secondary market is a market in which those who already have the shares and securities, they can go and buy and sell their shares. So in the capital markets, the secondary markets are in form of National Stock Exchange and the Bombay Stock Exchange, right? These stock exchanges are the primary, are the secondary markets, right? And when the company wants to come out with a public issue, it is called a primary market, from where the company collects the money. Now looking at the investment process, now you know that where can I go to invest in the securities? These are the financial markets, that the securities market prima facie, and what are the instruments that I have to use are the securities. Now let us start with the investment process. If I want to invest my money, then what is the process of investment? First of all, you will have to decide how much of money you want to invest. For how long do you want to invest? What are your expectations in terms of return? What are your risk perceptions? How much of risk are you ready to take? Right? That will give the investment policy. So investment policy should have the amount, should have the duration, the level of risk and the level of return. At least minimum these four things should be there in the investment policy. Okay? Then you, once you've decided that the period, you've decided the return that you're expecting, the amount of money that you're ready to invest, then we will be doing security analysis as to, out of thousands of securities which are available, in which particular security my particular desired objective can be achieved, right? So for that, I will do a security analysis and select certain securities. Now, once I've selected the securities, then I will have to invest in more than one security, right? Because I have to create a portfolio, I have to diversify. So then I will be constructing a portfolio by choosing out of those securities, which all are the securities in which I should invest, and how much of money should I invest in a particular security. So thereby I construct a portfolio. Then, you know, I constructed a portfolio with an objective in mind. After a certain period of time, say after 3 months or 6 months, I need to review that whether these securities are giving me the desired returns or not, or are giving me the desired results or not. So in that situation, if I find that my desired objective is not getting accomplished with the kind of portfolio that I've created, then I need to revise the portfolio and then again evaluate the performance and then again revise the portfolio if required. Right? So this is called the five steps of investment process. Now we'll be taking this investment process one by one. Let me first take the first step. So what do I do in the first step? I decide the investment policy. For that, I will have to look at the objective of the investor. How much of risk he is ready to take, how much of return that he is expecting from this particular investment. I also need to understand what is his investable wealth, how much of money is he ready to invest, and I will have to specify his risk and return objectives. Now risk is measured with the help of a tool we have been using, it the standard deviation. So in the complete security analysis also, we would be measuring the risk by using the concept of standard deviation. If you are still not clear with the concept of standard deviation, I would want you to please refer to the 11th standard or 12th standard books where this concept has been very beautifully explained. You can Google it out as well. This is a concept that you need to be thorough with, right? The concept of standard deviation we will be using for the purpose of measuring the risk, and we would be using the concept of capital asset pricing model. Some overview I had given to you when I was discussing with you the dividend policy. For the purpose of measuring the return, we would be using the CAPM model. Okay. So in this chapter, we're going to use two basic techniques, the standard deviation and the CAPM technique, to measure the risk and the return. Okay. Once I know the investor's objectives, once I know his wealth then I will find out that what are the potential investment categories for him. Should we invest his money in the capital market? Should I invest his money in the bond market? Or should his money, considering his perspective, right? How much risk he's ready to take? What is the time for which he's ready to invest the money? We'll be identifying the potential major investment categories. Having identified the potential major investment categories, then I need to do the security analysis within those categories, right? So then I would be finding out. Now, when I do the security analysis, what is my objective? I want to find out the mispriced securities. What I want to do? I want to find out the mispriced securities. Now, why I want to find out the mispriced securities? Because if a security would be undervalued, if a security would be undervalued as per my calculation, then I would buy that security. Because with the forces of demand and supply in place, very soon the security will come at its fair value and I would be able to get a return. And I would be able to get a desired return. So if the security will be undervalued, I will buy it. If the security will be overvalued, I will sell it. The point is getting clear? If the security will be undervalued, I would be buying it. If the security would be overvalued, I would be selling it. But for that, I will have to do the valuation. As per me, if the security, because for every individual investor, the value of the security will differ. Isn't it? For me, like, you know, when we do a kind of a bidding exercise or whatever, there is a property. Now, you know, everybody is bidding. Somebody is bidding for 1 crore, another one bids for 1 crore 25 lakhs, the third one bids for 1 crore 50 lakhs. So for every individual investor, the price of a security is different, right? To me, it seems that this particular property is undervalued for a crore of rupees. For you may feel that no, it is at a fair value, it's not undervalued, right? So every investor will have his own understanding about the pricing of a particular security. So to you, if it is undervalued, then we would be looking at it from the perspective of investment analysis using the techniques that we have. So as per investment analysis, if it is undervalued, then we suggest that you buy it. If it is as per investment analysis overvalued, then we suggest you sell it. Now in the markets, it is construction real sense meaning diversity. Construct in real sense means diversity. Construct a portfolio means create a portfolio. Okay? Is it not standard? No, there cannot be any standard. Dipali, just try and understand that whenever we do a valuation, we are using a rate of discounting. Right? We are using a rate of discounting. Generally, a valuation kaise karte ho? So, my discounting rate and your discounting rate is different because I am doing discounting at my required rate of return. You are doing discounting at your required rate of return. Right? And the market settles based upon the demand and supply. So, the majority of the investors, what is their required rate of return? That will determine the fair price of a particular security. Now, before I go further, I will also like to give you the differences between certain terminologies. Fair value, market value, book value. You might have heard these terms very regularly, right? Market value is the price which is prevailing in the market. Market value may or may not be a fair value. Right? Because at times you say that, you know, the real estate prices are inflated in the market. You hear these kinds of news. The property prices, they need to be corrected in the market. That means the market price is not the fair value. Market price is the price which is prevailing in the market. Fair value is the price which is based upon certain fundamental concepts. Right? On the basis of certain fundamental concepts, when you do the valuation, that is called a fair value. That you can say that, you know, this is based upon the present value of future cash flows. This can be based upon certain discounting techniques. But this is the fair value. This is based upon certain fundamental techniques. And book value is the value which is calculated using the book value of the assets and the book value of the liabilities. So the differences are clear? Based on the book values of assets and liabilities. Okay. So here we need to find out the mispriced securities, and for that we have to do the fundamental analysis. We have to find out the value, right? And then compare it with the market value. So if the fair value as per me is lower than the market value, in that situation I should sell it in the market because the securities would come down, right? Because fair value as per me is lower than the market value. But if fair value as per me is more than the market value, then I should buy that security, right? So I have to compare the current market price to the true market value or the fair market value, right? And then I will identify the undervalued securities and I would suggest buy those securities. And that's what you see it on CNN, IBN and many other financial market channels coming every day, where they say that, you know, this security is underpriced and you should buy it and hold it for this much period of time, and then you would be expecting this much of a price for those securities. So all this is based upon security analysis only. So now, having identified certain securities, what we do, we decide that how much proportion should be there in my portfolio of a security X, security Y and security Z, right? And then I construct a portfolio. Construction means I create a portfolio by deciding the proportion of individual securities in my total investment. Okay. So when I'm deciding upon constructing a portfolio, I have to address three issues. Yeah, it's like basket trading only. This term basket trading has come up from the concept where we say that if you want to move eggs from one place to another, we suggest do not keep all your eggs in one basket, right? You keep them separately. That's what is based upon the concept of, so do not keep all your investment in one security. Diversify it in different securities. That's why we require construction of a portfolio. Now, when you construct a portfolio, you will have to address the issues of selectivity, selection of the right kind of securities, right? Which are the securities that I want to select for the purpose of creating this portfolio? Timing, for how long a particular security has to remain in the portfolio. Because once I create the portfolio, that does not mean this portfolio is going to remain forever. There might be some securities which have to be sold earlier. There might be some securities which have to be kept for a longer period of time. So we have to look at the timing of the various investments in that particular portfolio. And then we have to look at that how much of diversification are we looking forward to. Do we want to do a very high level of diversification? The objective is to reduce the standard deviation. Okay. Now I have to periodically revise my portfolio. So I have to periodically see to it that my portfolio is giving me the desired returns. If it is not giving me the desired return, then I may increase some securities or I may decrease some securities. I may delete some securities and I may add some new securities. So I will have to continuously keep on reviewing my portfolio, revising my portfolio, evaluating my portfolio from the perspective of risk and return. Okay? Now, again and again, I'm talking about risk and return. So what is risk? What is risk? Okay, I ask this question to you first. What is risk? Identifying asset pro of wealth mean in which the invest money will be put. Identifying assets means identifying securities. Assets here, because they will become your assets, right? If I have invested my money in a particular security, that becomes my asset, that becomes an asset for me. Okay? Now, my next question is, what is risk? Risk kya hota hai? Is the chance of loss a risk? Exposed to danger. Is the ability to face uncertainty? No. Ability to take uncertainty, ability to face uncertainty is your risk, is your potential to take risk. I am saying, what is risk? Sneha is saying exposed to a danger. No, that is not risk. Yeah, risk is a potential chance of loss. Now, when I am talking about risk from the perspective of finance, yeah, there can be an uncertain event, right? So, when I am talking about risk from the perspective of finance, I am talking about a deviation from the expectation. I am talking about a deviation from the expectation. That is a risk. See, the thing is that if I am expecting 10% return, and if it is sure that I will get a 10% return, which many people call it as assured return, right? Then am I taking any risk? No. Risk is when that return can shift from 10% to 8%, or maybe 5%, or maybe 12%, or maybe 17%. So risk can be both sides, the upper side risk and the lower side risk. But from the perspective of investments, we look at risk from the negative side only. So we would be looking only at the left hand side, not at the right hand side. Okay, left means loss, right means profit. Okay. In case of gain, it is good for us. So we would not, see, we are conservative people. We are, while we are doing the investment, if I am expecting 10% return and if I get 15% return, I would call that my portfolio manager is very, very good and I will appreciate, right? And then, you know, I may decide to give him more money to invest, right? But when we talk about the negative side, here I want to be very, very, you know, very, very calculative as to how much of risk I'm taking. Risk is not bad in business, right? But if I am taking 1% risk, I should be getting 1% return as well. Higher the risk, higher the return. So I need to measure the risk so that I can expect a return accordingly. You're getting my point? So take, because I would be getting the return only when I am taking a risk. So risk is generally defined as an uncertainty which is because of occurrence of a particular loss. I am not going into objective risk or subjective. Okay, we can take it. Now, again, it's a very interesting thing. Let me take it. Again, you know, we can talk about objective risk and subjective risk. We would be talking only about objective risk in terms of numbers. Now, let me explain the difference between objective risk and subjective risk. See, one is risk. Risk is that there would be a deviation, there would the things will go, the return may not be as per expectation. So we can say deviation from expectation. Deviation from expected return. This is my risk. Okay. Now this can be measured. This can be measured. If my expected return was 12% and if I'm getting 8%, that means this risk can be measured. Any risk which can be measured is called objective risk. But then there is something called subjective risk. Subjective risk is dependent upon the risk perception of an individual. You know, there are people who are very, very scared of certain situations. So for one person, 1% loss may be a very big thing. For another, 1% loss might be a very small thing. That's a subjective risk. You're getting my point? For one person, if it is cloudy, he will say that the weather is very good. For another, it would be there are high chances of rain. For the third person, he would start preparing that the flood is going to come. And let us prepare for that. So, subjective risk is not being talked about over here. But yes, we have said that we have got three categories of investors: aggressive, conservative, and balanced. And there was a very beautiful quiz which I was reading in a newspaper called Times Wealth, which comes on every Monday in Economic Times. And he was trying to see as to what kind of an investor you are. I think I've not kept a copy of it, but it is available on internet also. So when we talk about investor, the investors are of three different kinds, and the kind of investor can be seen in his subjective risk. But in terms of numbers, we would be looking at only the objective risk, right? The difference is clear. Objective. So subjective risk is uncertainty based upon a person's mental condition or a state of mind. But objective risk is the variation of actual loss from the expected loss. Okay? In the financial markets, we take various kinds of risks because financial market is a market for getting return, so we need to take a risk. So there can be an interest rate risk. That means, what is an interest rate risk? On what kind of securities do we have interest rate risk? Any idea? What is interest rate risk? And who faces this interest rate risk? Market-based insurance policies. No, but then there is no interest rate risk in that. I am coming to Dipali's point, which is very, very clear. Borrowers and lenders face interest rate risk. How is it? That when you lend, I'm talking first from the perspective of a lender. A banker gives a 5-year loan, assuming at a fixed rate of interest of 10%. Right? And right now, at present, when he's giving the loan, he is accepting fixed deposits at the rate of 8%. But most of the situations, fixed deposits are kept for a period for 1 to 3 years. Now, supposing some of the securities mature during this period of 5 years and the market rate of interest rises, now in this situation, his new FDs that he will book will maybe in the range of 9 to 10%. And he may come in a situation where he's not even able to get his administrative expenses out of this particular deal. So the banker has taken a risk. He has accepted deposits for a smaller period at the rate of 8% and given a loan at 10%, but he has got a risk. If the interest rates in the market go up, he has given a fixed rate loan, he may not be able to get the fixed deposits at a lower rate of interest. That is the interest rate risk. Similarly, for the borrower, when he has taken a loan at the rate of 10% and supposing the market rate of interest goes down, he has taken a fixed rate loan at the rate of 10%, and if the market rate goes to 8% or 9%, he has taken a risk. Is the point getting clear? What is interest rate risk? The risk that the rate of interest may go down or may go up from the expected rates. Okay, that is a risk. The second is the foreign exchange risk, which a lot of exporters, importers, they are facing on a day-to-day basis because they have entered into commitments to get the money in future or maybe to pay the money in future, and the foreign exchange rates may fluctuate. Then is the credit risk. Credit risk is the risk which is taken by the lenders. What is this risk all about? That I have lent the money, I have given the money to somebody, someone has borrowed this money from me, and if he decides not to, if he does not repay the money, we do not call it a bad debt. Bad debt is a term which is used for debtors, when the debtors do not pay. When the borrowers do not pay, we call it a non-performing asset. So the difference between the two is clear? Okay. So a borrower may not repay the money, that is my credit risk. Next is the market risk. Market risk is because the price of the security may come down, right? I have purchased a security for 100 rupees expecting that it will go to 150, but the security comes down to 90 rupees. That's the market risk because of volatility in the markets, market prices of certain assets. Then you have a liquidity risk. That is where, you know, you were talking about some life insurance policies, etc. Supposing you want to get your money back, but you cannot sell those investments. That's a liquidity risk. The investment is not very liquid. And because the investment is not liquid, so whenever you want to encash it, you're not able to do it. That's a liquidity risk. This also happens when we invest in some of the very small cap companies. And later on, we realize that these companies have... There are no buyers for the shares of these companies, and we face a liquidity risk with respect to these investments. Then there can be a political risk. Political risk is the risk because of a political system of a particular country. At times, you know, there can be a political unrest, or there can be a coalition government coming up, or there might be certain, you know, situations of emergency in a country. And because of that, you know, the complete financial markets get disturbed. So that's called a political risk, right? You can add to it various other risks as well. This is a very small list of the various kinds of risks which are prevailing in the financial markets. And because we take these risks, so we expect a return, isn't it? Wherever there will be a risk, we would like to get it compensated by a return. Now, because we've got various kinds of risks, if I look at it purely from the risk management perspective, not from the return perspective, in that situation, because one is that we want return, but at the same time, we want to reduce the risk, right? So if I look at from the perspective of reducing the risk, I will be dividing these risks into, these investments into four categories. I'm creating a matrix here. In this matrix, let us assume that, let us assume that this axis is showing you severity of loss. What does this mean? That in case the wrong event happens. Supposing I have invested in the shares of a company. Supposing there is going to be a loss. Then how severe can this loss be? How much of loss can I face? Okay. And the second criteria is, the y-axis, which I will write over here, is the frequency of loss. What are the chances that the losses would be very, very frequent? Right? So, when the frequency will increase, we'll go on this axis. When the severity will increase, we'll go on this axis. Fine? So, can I create a matrix over here? The first is high severity and the situation where I'm saying that the severity is high, but the frequency is low. That means there are lower chances of loss. But if the loss will happen, then it will be very, very severe. This is generally a situation when we take a life insurance. The chances of death are low. But if the person who is the earning member of the family, if he goes, then the severity and the severity otherwise also is very, very high. Right? So in a situation where frequency is low and severity is high, how should we manage the risk? We should go for insurance. Fine with us? The second situation is where the severity is low and the frequency is also low. If the severity is also low, that in case there is going to be a loss, the chance of loss is very low. And in case there will be a loss, then the severity is also low, we'll say retain this loss. Don't do anything. You know, retain this risk. Itna risk to insaan ko life mein lena hi padega na. Ki bhai, aap sadak par ja rahe hain aur aap apni jagah pe pahunch jayenge. Aap gali mohalle mein ghoom rahe hain. So in that situation, the frequency of an accident is also low. And agar kahin koi kisi ka pair wire fisal bhi gaya, to nuksan bhi zyada nahi hoga. So we say retain this loss. Right? Retain this risk, not the loss. Retain this risk. Do not do anything in this kind of a situation. The third situation is where the frequency is high but the severity is low. Ye kaisi situation hai? This I generally give an example of a grocery store. Yahan pe kya hota hai ki agar koi dekhne wala nahi ho to bahut se log chote chote saman utha ke le jayenge. So severity is low but the chances of people picking up small things is very high. Right? So in this situation the risk management can be by way of loss control. So yahan par aapko technology use karni chahiye. What you should do, you should put up CCTV cameras, or you can put up, you know, the barcoding systems or security systems, so that this kind of a loss can be avoided. Right? Try to avoid this loss by going for risk control techniques. Do not avoid it completely. You can use the risk control techniques over here. The fourth situation is where frequency is low. No. Frequency is high and severity is also high. Yes? Yehi fourth situation reh gayi hamari. Frequency is high and severity is also high. What we will say? Do not do this work. Jahan par frequency bhi zyada hai, severity bhi zyada hai. Like we say that while you are driving on a highway, do not drive very fast. Do not do drink and drive on a highway. Because the frequency otherwise is also very high, and you know, frequency of an accident in such a situation is very high, and if an accident will happen, the severity will also be high. Do not do those kinds of activities. Is the risk matrix getting clear? Now you would question me that, ma'am, in case of situations where we are investing in capital markets, how do we handle the risks? How do we handle the risks? In the capital markets, we would be using this combination of risk matrix, but in most of the situations where the frequency is low and severity is high, in the capital market, we would be going for hedging techniques. And in order to reduce the risk, we also go for diversification. So these are the techniques which we are going to use in the capital markets for reducing the severity and reducing the frequency. Fine with us? Another technique which you know, why we call it as an investment, and we do not, in the fourth situation, what to do? Do not take the risk. If the frequency is also high and severity is also high, do not do that business. Avoid it completely. Okay? Now, because we are saying that financial investments are such that where, you know, we can analyze a situation, we need to take a very conscious decision. So we need to also do loss forecasting. We have to forecast the loss in advance. We have to predict the loss. That what can be the maximum loss? What can be the maximum loss? And we should be prepared for that, right? So this can be done through various techniques. We would be discussing in the next class about the probability analysis. We would be discussing as to what are the chances of loss and how much can be the loss in a given situation. That we can do with the help of probability analysis, which is a very, very simple technique. We can also use regression analysis, but for that we require to create a computerized model. So this is outside the scope of your particular course curriculum, which you might have done in your statistics, etc. So you can create a regression model and you can do the forecasting of the losses based upon by deciding various variables, right? So you can do a two variable regression analysis, or you can do a multivariable regression analysis as well. The third technique is forecasting based upon loss distribution. So again, it comes from probability analysis and frequency distribution, which I would be discussing with you. So probability analysis and loss distribution, both are the techniques that we're going to utilize for the purpose of loss forecasting in this particular course. But at the same time, generally when we do the forecasting, it is based upon the historical experiences, because we cannot forecast anything without any support. And support we get from the historical evidences only. But please be very, very careful. Whatever we are forecasting is based upon the historical data, and it is not a guarantee that losses will follow the past trends, but still the chances are very, very high. So all the forecasting that we are going to do, that will be based upon the past data only. So when we do a probability analysis, we just try to assign the individual probabilities to various events. We try to divide the various kinds of the event into lot of exposure units, and we try to find out by using the probability analysis as to what kind of scenarios can exist out of a particular situation. I would be doing it with the help of examples here. Regression, I've already discussed with you that we can have two or more variables, and then we can predict the value of a particular independent variable using some of the dependent variables. And the loss forecasting with the use of loss distribution table again uses a probability distribution only, where we will be doing the concept of value at risk. Now, when we talk about risk coverage, as I said that we can take various kinds of risks in the financial markets. As I've already discussed with you, one way of covering risk is taking insurance. But in the financial markets, we take various risks for which insurance is not available. We are going to talk about the risk that we are going to take by buying certain securities, by investing in certain investments. So there is no insurance which is available for the investment markets. Here we will have to do the risk management by using the various techniques of loss forecasting and taking the concepts of, as I've discussed with you, hedging. We can use derivative instruments. We can use hedging earlier, derivatives earlier, and we can use diversification. Yep. So we can use diversification, we can use derivatives, we can use the hedging techniques in order to manage our risk in the financial markets. There is no insurance. Okay. So I am going to close it over here, because in the next class I just gave you an overview of the topic today. In the next class, I would be discussing with you the tools and techniques of risk management. And for that, ma'am, then where do we use speculation? Speculation is something that we are going to use, that is not the method used by an investor, right? Speculation is something which is for those who do not do security analysis. ठीक है, speculate वो लोग करते हैं जो analysis नहीं करते. हम क्या करेंगे? हम कभी भी speculate नहीं करेंगे, right Sneha? In this invest security analysis and portfolio management, we will never ever speculate. We will always analyze and invest. ठीक है? Yeah, coming to your FTFM homework, I have already seen Dipali's homework. Dipali has done that question. Credit policy is correct, right? And certain level of, I think, bad debts was also given to you, if I'm not wrong. Nahin. Is question mein aapko bad debts nahin diye gaye the. Only you were given various credit policies, and you were required to find out that which particular credit policy is best using the incremental analysis. Now, when I was looking at your answer, Ganesh, there are two, three things which I wanted to first of all inform you. When we calculate the investment in debtors, And when variable cost and fixed cost has been given to us and different policies and different sales levels have been given to us, you have to calculate debtors on the cost price and not on the selling price. You have to calculate debtors on costs, not on selling price, because why are we changing the credit policy and showing you the sales? Because we also want to utilize the leverage of the fixed cost. You're getting my point? So, आपका जो calculation होगा, that आपने जो calculation किया है, you have calculated debtors on the selling price, on sales. You had to calculate debtors on cost. Okay? So, I'll show you the solution from the suggested answers. In this, if you evaluate the proposed credit policies, you can see that these were the proposed credit policies here. Annual sales you had already been given. Variable cost is 80% of sales. You've calculated it correctly. Fixed cost remains constant. You've also calculated it correctly. You have not calculated total cost because you are doing your analysis on sales. You had to calculate total costs, and then you had to find out the profit also, which was a difference between the sales and the total cost. Then you had to find out the average investment in debtors. Average investment in debtors, you can see here, it has been calculated on cost. You have done it on sales. So that is the difference. Now, once you get the average investment in debtors, then what you have to see? You have to see the incremental cost and the incremental revenue. Right? So average investment will also, now in order to find out incremental cost, you've also done the same thing. You've calculated 20% of the incremental investment. You can do it 20% of the investment and then find out the incremental investment, or you can find out 20% of the incremental investment, whichever is comfortable to you. So now you've found out the average investment, you can find out 20% of that to find out the cost of debtors. Having found out the cost of debtors, then you have to see that whether the increase in profit is more or increase in cost is more, right? And whichever policy gives you the maximum benefit, you will follow that policy. Your answer is coming as policy A. If you do it on cost basis, the answer which is coming is policy B. So, thoda sa isko fir se review karne ki zarurat hai. The calculation on the cost of debtors, not on the selling price. सारी कैलकुलेशन वहीं से चेंज हो गई आपकी. इज इट गेटिंग क्लियर? राइट? सो आई थिंक वी कैन क्लोज इट हियर. द फर्स्ट वन इज समथिंग व्हिच आई हैव ऑलरेडी डिस्कस्ड इन द क्लास, तो उसको मैंने बहुत ज्यादा गौर से नहीं देखा है. एंड इट्स ऑन द सिमिलर लाइंस दैट आई हैड डिस्कस्ड इन द क्लास. सो आपने इसको मंथली बेसिस पे निकाल दिया है और हमने क्लास में इसको एनुअल बेसिस पे किया था. सो दैट इज द ओनली डिफरेंस. बट द आंसर, योर आंसर इज ऑल्सो करेक्ट, सो दैट्स नॉट अ प्रॉब्लम. ठीक है जी. सो विद दिस वी क्लोज द डिस्कशन फॉर टुडे. यू कैन स्टार्ट रीडिंग द सिक्योरिटी एनालिसिस चैप्टर, द थ्योरेटिकल पार्ट, द फर्स्ट पैराग्राफ, द सेकेंड पैराग्राफ, द फर्स्ट पेज, सेकेंड पेज, थर्ड पेज, टू एन एक्सटेंट दैट यू कैन अंडरस्टैंड. यू कैन स्टार्ट रीडिंग इट. यू कैन ऑल्सो स्टडी द फाइनेंशियल मार्केट्स चैप्टर नाउ, because I've given you the overview of financial markets. Rather than studying security markets, rather, I would want you to study the chapter on financial markets, which is in your syllabus, and come up with your questions in the next class on financial markets. Okay? You will have your FTFM test on Saturday. So then you will have Sunday and Monday to study before we have a class on Tuesday. So Sunday, Monday, you can study the financial markets chapter. And in case you've got any questions there, we can discuss it in the next class. Okay? Yeah, exam preparatory will be full working capital. Okay? So with this, we close the discussion right now over here. Good night. All the best for both the exam preparatories. Do well, study well, prepare well. Good night to all of you. Take care of yourselves.